I've only ever seen one trial that tried to reverse heart disease, tried to reduce the plaque in the arteries by cutting carbs. I've never seen this trial covered on social media, and it has some significant limitations, I'm warning you right now, but it also has some really interesting lessons. And I think the results of this trial are going to surprise a lot of people. The study is called Dietary Intervention to Reverse Carotid Atherosclerosis. Carotids are the arteries in the neck that take blood up to the brain, and atherosclerosis is plaque in the arteries. It's artery disease, cardiovascular disease. So the idea is to give people different diets and see if we can shrink the plaque in the arteries, see if we can reverse heart disease or cardiovascular disease. So they recruited 140 participants, and they all had to be between 40 and 65, and they had to have a BMI of at least 27, or they had to have type 2 diabetes or coronary heart disease. And this was a weight loss trial, so they were shooting to get some weight loss. These participants were all overweight or obese, and the participants were 88% males. Now, this I know frustrates a lot of our female viewers. A lot of the times they complain in the comments, why are these trials often skewed to males? It's not that that the researchers are sitting there going, let's just recruit men because who cares about, it's not that, right? It's that they usually have these criteria. They have to have certain conditions, especially for a reversal trial, right? You have to have the disease in the first place. And so you're recruiting people that are sicker, and just statistically, that tends to be more men, because men tend to be more messed up than women are. Men live shorter lives than women because we have to put up with women our whole lives, right? I think everybody knows this. No, it's partly genetics and partly because men don't take care of themselves as well as women do. We eat worse statistically, right? In general, we eat worse, we exercise less or move around less, we smoke more, we drink more, yada, yada, yada. So they took these 140 people that they recruited and they split them randomly in three groups. One group was told to cut carbs, the other group was told to cut fat, and the third group was told to eat a Mediterranean diet. Okay, let's talk about what the goals actually were. In the fat reduction group, they were supposed to get about 30% of their calories from fat. And I know we have viewers who have very strong views that that is not a low-fat diet. Everybody's got their own notion of what a low-fat diet is, what can receive that name. So we're not going to call it low-fat. Even though the authors of the study did call it low-fat in the title of one of their publications, we're not going to call it low-fat. We're going to call it fat reduction or lower fat, because they did get less fat than the other groups. All right, that way, everybody's still friends. And so they ended up getting about 30% of their calories from fat, so they complied with the instructions. On the Mediterranean diet, it was about 33, and on the lower-carb diet, it was 38, 39. So there was a significant difference between the groups in the amount of fat they were eating. Now, the carb reduction group, the instructions were to get about 20 grams of carbs a day for the first couple months. And then after that, to slowly go up to a maximum of 120 grams of carbs per day. Their idea was that they would lose weight in with the initial restriction, and then they would try to maintain the weight loss with that gradual increase. Same thing here. Some people are gonna say that's too low carb. Some people are gonna say it's not low carb enough. We're not going to call it low carb. We're going to call it carb reduction or lower carb, because it is lower than the other groups. That way, we don't have to have a war over semantics. Okay, now it gets even worse for people who are upset that this isn't low carb enough. It gets worse because this is what they asked the participants to do, but the participants couldn't even do that. They couldn't go that far. So they actually ended up getting about 40% of their calories from carbs, which is significantly more than what they asked. And on the other two groups, the fat restriction and the Mediterranean groups, they were getting about 50%. So they did reduce carbs compared to before and compared to the other groups, but they couldn't get to the target, and we're not going to call it low carb. All right. Another thing that's important to point out, the trial was structured where both the Mediterranean and the fat restriction group had a cap for calories. So women were supposed to stay at about 1,500 calories a day, men 1,800, whereas the carb restriction group didn't have a cap for calories. They were supposed to cut the carbs, but eat as many calories as they wanted. Despite this, they ended up, all three groups reduced their calories, and actually similarly, they ended up eating about the same number of calories throughout. All right, what actual foods were they told to eat? Because that's always crucial. So for the fat restriction and for the Mediterranean diet groups, the advice was pretty typical. So for the lower fat group, they were advised fruits and vegetables, grains, legumes, and limiting added fats and sweets. So not a lot of refined carbs and added sugars, but focusing on whole carbs. So pretty standard whole food, low fat, high carb advice. And the Mediterranean was a typical traditional Mediterranean diet as defined in research studies. So fruits and vegetables, olive oil, nuts, fish, poultry, and moderate or low in red meats. So nothing too surprising for those two groups. Now, the carb restriction group was interesting. They actually advised vegetarian sources of fat and protein. So either plant sources or dairy or eggs. And they also recommended avoiding trans fats. So because of this recommendation, the amount of saturated fat in all groups was pretty close. Sometimes this is not the case. Sometimes in trials with low carb diets, we see 30% of their calories coming from saturated fat. Not the case here. Here it was 12% and about 10% on the other two groups. So pretty close. Now the carb restriction group also got more unsaturated fats, things like olive oils and fish and nuts, than the other two groups. So they were getting more fat overall, more saturated, a little bit more saturated, but also more unsaturated. All right, before we get to the results, let's look at the sample menu, kind of a typical day of eating on each diet. So example day on the fat restriction, whole wheat bread, low-fat cheese, some vegetables, some fruit, roasted chicken breast, potatoes, more vegetables, more low-fat dairy, and on and on. There's an energy bar there. So it's mostly whole carbs, some low-fat dairy, not candy and soda. The most processed thing on here is the energy bar, depending which brand. Everything else is pretty solid, pretty healthy foods. Example day on the Mediterranean, coffee with low-fat milk, whole wheat bread, low-fat dairy, cheese, vegetables, fruit, grilled fish, legumes, another salad with olive oil, low-fat yogurt, some more low-fat dairy, etc., etc. So pretty similar to the fat restriction diet, right? The main difference being these guys had a bit more added fat, mainly olive oil and nuts. Example, carb restriction, walnuts, high-fat cheese, fried chicken breasts, vegetables, tahini, turkey pastrami, tuna fish. So again, there's a lot of similarities, a lot of commonalities between the three. Here, the dairy is high-fat, that's one difference. And some foods are fried instead of baked or grilled, and they got rid of bread. Other than that, pretty similar. And all three diets are mostly pretty healthy foods. We can find one or two things to pick on. The energy bar, the pastrami is, I think it's processed meat. Other than that, pretty healthy overall. I mean, any of these three menus, if most Westerners were gonna go on any of these diets, it'd be a godsend. So the participants were kept on these diets for 2 years. That was the follow-up. And there was no significant difference in physical activity between the groups. So the diet is the main intervention. Let's look at the results. So weight loss looked like this. Blue is low carb, so they lost weight faster, up to about 6 months. Now there's always some debate, this initial weight loss. Is it fat? Is it water weight because of the glycogen? Anyway, they dropped body weight faster. Then there's a rebound. And by 1 year, they're tied. No significant difference with Mediterranean, which is the yellow line. And 2 years, both still tied. And the fat restriction is the red line. So there's an initial drop, there's some rebound, and it's not as effective as the other two, maybe 40% less effective, but all three accomplish weight loss. And in all three, there's some degree of sustained weight loss all the way to 2 years. All right, next let's look at the results for ApoB. This is really interesting. So lower carb diet actually dropped ApoB more. That's the blue line. 6 months, it's lower than the others. Again, there's a rebound on all three. This is pretty common, these rebounds. It's frustrating to see, but this is common in diet trials. Most people can't stick with most diet interventions, really. By the 2 year mark, the Mediterranean diet, that's green, is back to baseline. The lower fat diet, that's red, is back to baseline, maybe even a little higher than baseline. And the lower carb diet is the only one that holds a little bit of reduction. So this will surprise a lot of people because low carb has this reputation for messing up your cholesterol, messing up your ApoB. But it's not the carb restriction that does that. It's whatever you're eating that determines your biomarkers, right? So The main factor is the quality of the fats that you're eating. If your low-carb diet is bacon and lard and butter everywhere and no fiber, yeah, I expect for most people, cholesterol and ApoB are going to go up. But if it's some fatty fish, some fermented dairy, vegetables, olive oil, nuts, it may not elevate your cholesterol and ApoB at all. And depending on what you were eating before, I would expect an improvement. The other thing to point out is that it's not just saturated fat. Sometimes this is oversimplified. People say, if you eat saturated fat, you get, your cholesterol goes up. As we see here, the lower carb group were getting a little bit more saturated fat, 12% of their calories as opposed to 10% on the other groups, but they were also getting more unsaturated fats. And it's that ratio of unsaturated to saturated that's a very powerful driver of cholesterol and ApoB. In fact, if you remember, they were getting almost 40% of their calories from fat. It was 38 or 39, and only 12% were saturated. So the vast majority are unsaturated. So that ratio is going to be pretty favorable. And we even know how this works. The type of fat affects the receptors on the liver that pull ApoB from the blood. So foods like butter and fatty meats reduce those receptors, and foods that are richer in unsaturated fats like olive oil or nuts, they increase those receptors, so more ApoB gets pulled from the blood. Oh, and the weight loss helps these lipids as well. So if you are overweight and you lose some weight, in general, cholesterol and ApoB improve. All right, now the results on the arteries, the main thing this trial was reporting. And again, like we said, they looked at the carotid arteries in the neck, and they used ultrasound to measure the artery wall. And the thickness of the wall of the carotid overall total wall was reduced in all the participants combined by 5%. This reduction was 61 cubic millimeters averaged on the fat restriction group, 38 on the Mediterranean, and 84 on the carb restriction group. Although there was no significant difference between the groups, that could be because there's no real difference and they all reduce it similarly, or it could be because we don't have enough statistical power to detect the difference between the groups. And if you had more people or even longer follow-up or something like that, that you would be able to detect a difference. Both possible. I told you there are some limitations, right? And we're only getting started. Here we go with the biggest limitation. This measure that we just went over is total thickness of the artery wall. It's not specifically the plaque. It's every layer of the wall. So we can't say that the plaque was reduced based on that. Now there's a more specific measure called IMT, intimal medial thickness, and they did measure that. So that looks at the two innermost layers of the wall, and that dropped by 1.1% in all the participants combined, although that reduction was not statistically significant. And they don't report the IMT reduction for each group, which is annoying, and I'm sure we're going to hear some strongly worded views about that in the comments. They do say, however, that there was no significant difference between the three groups in this reduction in IMT, for what it's worth. So this IMT is a more specific measurement than the whole artery wall thickness, although it still looks at two layers, not specifically at plaque. So this is the main limitation of the trial, in my view, is they don't measure plaque specifically. It could be that plaque got reduced, or it could be that the muscle layer got reduced, or a number of possibilities. They also don't report events, actual heart attacks and strokes and things like that at the end of the day. That's what we want to know. All of these artery wall measurements are always surrogates, are always guesstimates of risk of events. All groups saw a reduction in the thickness of the artery wall, no significant difference between them. The carb restriction group trended towards a stronger result in reduction of artery wall thickness. That makes sense to me. That's kind of unsurprising given the results. The ApoB reduction was stronger than the other diets. The weight loss was the strongest, tied with Mediterranean. And these are the key factors. It's the impact on these causal biomarkers. At an individual level of each person making a decision, if you like eating a low-carb diet, and if your composition of a low-carb diet for your genetics lowers your ApoB, lowers your body weight, puts your body weight and your body fatness in the optimal range, great. No problems with that. If it doesn't, find something else. Make tweaks, change it. One of the main takeaways for me is that all three diets were put together overwhelmingly with high quality, healthy foods. That's the main thing. What actual foods are you eating? Is it a health promoting dietary pattern overall? The macro distribution, amount of fats, amount of carbs, whatever works for you. Did you know that exercise has been shown scientifically to help reverse heart disease, shrink the plaque in the arteries. We covered all of that in this video, so check it out. I'll meet you in there.